Good morning, children of God. This second day of September 2020, it's a Wednesday, and we want to invite you from wherever you are to settle down and tune in, and we want to believe that God is going to minister to you this morning. And as we begin our service, we're going to sing a hymn, "All People That on Earth Do Dwell." So we shall stand and join that hymn. Praise you, we give you glory, we give you the honor because of your love that is unconditional. For every blessing that you've bestowed unto us, receive praise, receive honor, receive the adoration. And as we continue in your presence this morning, may you, Lord God, come and meet us, bless us, speak to us. May your name be glorified. We thank you and we praise you. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily food. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. As we continue, we're going to sit and listen to the reading of God's word, led by our sister, Reverend Lovin Sakatana.
Our reading this morning comes to us from Genesis chapter 37, reading from verse 1. Genesis 37, reading from verse 1. Jacob lived in the land where his father had stayed, the land of Canaan. This is the account of Jacob. Joseph, a young man of 17, was tending the flocks with his brothers, the sons of Bilhah and the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives, and brought their father a bad report about them. Now Israel loved Joseph more than any of his other sons, because he had been born to him in old age, and he made a richly ornamented robe for him. When his brothers saw that the father loved him more than any of them, they hated him and could not speak a kind word to him. Joseph had a dream, and when he told it to his brothers, they hated him all the more. He said to them, "Listen to this dream I had. We were binding sheaves of corn out in the field, when suddenly my sheaf rose and stood upright, while your sheaves gathered around mine and bowed down to it." His brothers said to him, "Do you intend to reign over us? Will you actually rule us?" And they hated him all the more because of his dream and what he had said. Then he had another dream and told it to his brothers. "Listen," he said, "I had another dream, and this time the sun and the moon and 11 stars were bowing down to me." When he told his father as well as his brothers, his father rebuked him and said, "What is this dream you had? Will your mother and I and your brothers actually come and bow down to the ground before you?" His brothers were jealous of him, but his father kept the matter in mind. This is the word of God.
Thanks be to God. Amen. Brethren, this morning we are again privileged to have in our midst our friend, our father in the Lord, the retired bishop of Mighty West Nile Diocese, the Right Reverend Joel Obetia. He's going to be bringing to us God's word this morning. And for us here at UCU, we make a joke, but a very serious one. He's our resident bishop. He's a very humble man, very peaceful man, and today we are going to be hearing God speak through him. So I want you to look forward to the message that is going to be brought. Before we have him speak to us, I'm going to ask us to stand again and sing another hymn, "Lord, Make Us Instruments of Your Peace."
Instruments of peace. Let us pray to the Lord as we come to the Word. Father, we want to thank you for this morning. We thank you that you have brought us up to September. And now we want to give thanks to you. The 3 months remaining before us are in your hands. And we ask that, Lord, you will remind us of your goodness for the 9 months that we have covered. We bless your holy name and we pray for the university community as they are scattered throughout this world. And we ask that, Lord, their hearts and our hearts will be joined together as we share your word. Speak to us as a speaking God. You are not like the idols, you are not like other gods, but you are our God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who speaks in very clear terms and in our terms. And so, Lord, take this moment and use it for your glory through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Thank you. We may be seated. A very warm welcome to you all on this midweek service in the month of September. This has been an eventful week for us here in Uganda Christian University. We have a very brand new chancellor, and we have this last Sunday installed a brand new vice chancellor. Professor Aaron and your family, you are most welcome into our community, the community of UCU. We rejoice with you and your family for taking the courage to come, because these are very tough times where only people of faith and people of courage can take new assignments as you have done. You have been prepared for some time, but preparation is not actually doing the thing. Now you are in it for real. So you have given us a glimpse of who you are, and this gives us courage too. A very old Lugbara proverb says, courage needs company. Courage needs company. It means if the consequence of your failure as a leader is great on the people who are following after you or who are looking to you, as a leader, you need to take up courage for their sake. And so, somebody who is alone and who is being followed by nobody cannot take up courage. You are tempted to run because there is no consequence of your lack of courage. But if there are people looking to you, you are forced to stand and you're forced to take courage for their sake if you are a good leader. And so what you have done to take up this role as the incoming vice chancellor gives us courage also to stand, because if you ran away, our courage will melt and we will all scatter. And so one day when Jesus did this, what you have done, after the death of Lazarus. Lazarus was sick and news came to Jesus that your friend is sick. But Jesus lingered much longer, and actually for 4 days. And then he said, we must go to Bethany. Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep. They didn't understand what he was saying, and they then said, Lazarus is dead and we must go. Now, the disciples made sure they reminded Jesus that the Jewish leaders were looking for Jesus. That how can you go near Jerusalem when you know that in Jerusalem they are waiting for you to kill you? They will arrest you and they want to kill you. Jesus said some things in John chapter 11. And so there is this one man who is just typical of us called Thomas. Thomas said, let us also go that we may die with him. Now, all of us call Thomas the doubting Thomas, and we give him. This is a man of resolve. When he saw the courage of Jesus to go even near Jerusalem, he said, let us also go with him so that we may die with him. John chapter 11, verse 16, part B. We assure you, as the community of UCU, we assure you, Professor Aaron and your wife Patience, we assure you that we have come to die with you. We have resolved to die with you in this venture of being vice chancellor in a very tough time, very difficult moment when the university is not operating as a university, but just like any other village. Any village, this is what any village would look like. No students, no activities, just, you know, people doing a few things here and there. That is the university to which you have come to be the vice chancellor. And we are here because of what you did on Sunday. We are here to tell you that we are ready to die with you in this venture. And so, while you come in, we want to wish Doctors John and Ruth Senyonyi, a quiet retirement, watching your grandchildren grow and new ones come. So we wish you well in your retirement. So, Genesis chapter 37 brings us to a small family, not small in the sense of some of the modern things that are happening around the family, but a family, one family in which there are about four mothers. There was Leah, there is Rachel, there is a Bilha, and there is Zilpa. So this is the family of 12 children, one daughter only, mainly men. This is the family of Jacob, the one who took the blessings from Esau, his brother. Now he is settled in the promised land, in the land of his fathers, with his family. Joseph is just 17, the second youngest of the children. He had a younger brother called Benjamin. So Joseph, just a lad of 17 years, and a lot of responsibility was being laid on his shoulder at this very moment, at this time. Joseph was not an idle member of the family. He was a very active member. He gave his brothers three reasons to hate him. Three reasons to hate him. The first one is that he snitches, or he tells, or he informs on his brothers, especially the stepbrothers. Whenever they went to tend the animals and to look after the sheep and the goats, all their misdemeanors, Joseph will come and tell the father, "Our brother did this, my so-and-so brother did this, and he did, oh, he stole this." And that was one problem that Joseph caused in that family. The second reason why they would hate him, it is not Joseph's fault, but it is a fault anyway. The father's preferential open love for Joseph than the rest of the other 11 children. The father loved Joseph more, and to show that, he bought a multicolored dress, a gown, and made it for Joseph. That didn't go well for these young people. Finally, Joseph was a dreamer, and for his dreams he was hated. He had two dreams. The first dream of sheaves, when all the other sheaves laid down and his stood up and all the others fell down before. And then the dream of the sun, the moon, and the 11 stars falling at the feet of Joseph. The father knew what this was meaning, and the children all knew what Joseph was insinuating, and they hated him for that. Now, is there a brother on whom you have never snitched? You have never sneaked behind and told some mommy, "This is what happened. This is what happened." Yes, brothers are so. I had a younger brother who always told on me and informed my father of some of my misdemeanors. So we fought, we did a lot of things. So in trying to get your brothers into trouble, you go and report them. You report them. That's a normal family. That's a normal family. The second reason is nothing to do with Joseph, that the father loved him more. Maybe because the father loved the mother more or whatever, but the father loved him. Now, this is not his fault. How can you tell your father to love you less? No, you can't. You just enjoy, you revel in the love of your father. I remember when my father used to pick my younger brother on his lap, it was always very painful. I would come and stand close to him so that he can also notice that I'm a son in order to pick me. When he picks both of us, we are happy, but my feet will go to my brother and kick his knee, and he will kick me, and the war will start there and then. So this is what happens in a normal family. Yes, snitching on your brothers, or trying to get your father's or your guardian's attention is always so. I remember, I think it was in 1965, I was about about 6 or 7 years old, and my father went to town and bought some dress for me. It was what we used to call American khaki, and a shirt from Uganda Garment Industry, UGIL, here, which was called Yamato. They were sealed and covered, and that was my first sealed brand new dress. When they landed that thing onto my laps, about 6 p.m. in the evening, that was the end of my sleep. Because I knew most of the others didn't have anything like that. So the next day was Christmas. I could not sleep. I was just waiting for the cock crow so that I'll go into my new dress and I'll go out to show my new self to my brothers and sisters. It was a very traumatic night for me. There was no sleep. I would wake up, touch the covering and say, yeah, it is still here. It is still here. By 6, I was already in my dress. So that was the love that I was coveting from my father. It is something that my cousins and brothers hated. They really resented it. But that's what happens in a normal family. They envied me, but they didn't know the way I suffered that night, because there was no sleep. I was awake all through. For the dreams, if the dreams came to maybe somebody who was much older, but this was a 17-year-old boy, you can't blame him for a lot of the things that happened in his life. He couldn't stop but blabber about and take pride into these dreams and just blast them into the family. And that was causing more problems. The sheaves, how can sheaves that have been gathered and you have tied them and yours stands and then the rest come under you? And how can the sun, the moon, and the stars all come at your feet? These people knew what Joseph was meaning, that he was going to be over them all. And brothers and sisters, in the order of their birth, the eldest will always want to be in front, will have the first cut. So that is what was happening. Joseph suffered for these things that were either done to him or done by him or done to him by his brothers. But Joseph had a destiny. There was a destiny. He was just an uninformed young boy who was trying to do what God was trying to do in his life. He had to travel about 100 miles because from where they were living, the distance from Hebron to Shechem and to Dothan, that is almost 100. It's from down in Hebron all the way, midway, almost through the Samaritan land and almost to the Sea of Galilee. And that was a long distance for a 17-year-old. He traveled that, but he was traveling to a destiny. He was traveling to a destiny. He traveled that distance and found his brothers almost 100 miles away. He made it in order that he will meet with his fate. So his tough and trying times began immediately. He took that journey to check on his brothers. They said, "The dreamer has come. Let us kill him." The initial mission was to kill him. Then Judah was against that. Reuben was against that. They tried to throw him in a well. And then all of a sudden, some Ishmaelites appeared. And they said, "Yes, this is the best option. Let's kill a lamb, mingle it with his blood, with the lamb, the blood of the lamb, and take it to the father, the very dress that he was bought by the father, and then we'll say some wild animal had consumed him." The times we are in are like the times in the life of little Joseph, 17-year-old lad. This year stands out. In all our lives, it stands out. These are tough times. This is a very tough year. The year 2020, a very, a very fanciful name, 2020. Some people 2020, some people call it different ways. Americans call differently, Italians call different. Even us Ugandans, we call it differently. So 2020 is a unique year. I'm just waiting to see if Ugandans, as wise as they are not going to use this year as a swear word. Say, if you hit your nail with a hammer or you hurt your nail, you say, "Oh, 2020. You exclaim using the word, because it's a strange year, 2020. 2020 has become, it will soon become the most dangerous year in our lives. So we swear with it. We swear with the, with this year. It's saying, "Oh God," you just say, "Oh 2020," as an exclamation. I remember it was Job. Because of his suffering, he wanted to curse the day of his birth. He said, "Cursed is this day of my birth." 2020 is becoming a year, a cursed year of our lives. Soon we will begin to curse the year 2020. If anything bad happens to us, we say, "Oh, 2020. So, for Joseph, it was not a pandemic. It wasn't like ours. But real suffering in the hands of his own brothers and in a maximum prison like Luzira, after a woman, his master's wife, desired him and tried to seduce him, to no avail. I do not understand why Potiphar couldn't kill him, didn't just kill him. I think he had an inkling that this woman is lying. That's why, instead of killing Joseph, He just took him into the loserer of Egypt. So why didn't he do that? If someone, let alone a Hebrew slave, touches my wife, and I'm an Egyptian officer called Potiphar, why shouldn't I kill this man? Why? Why not? The only plausible reason Potiphar didn't do this is that the Bible gives it to us, and it is here in our reading, that God was with Joseph. Hallelujah. The Lord was with Joseph. So, how do you explain your survival up to this far? In fact, when we were coming here, we were saying on 20th of this month, September, we're going to make 6 months with COVID as Ugandans. Of course, COVID began in November last year. In November, December last year, the year 2019, it has become part of the name of the virus itself, COVID-19. Yes, the COVID began, but in Uganda, we will be making 6 months on the 20th that we are under this influence of COVID, the coronavirus. So, many people have died. In other parts of the world, even in Uganda, the number is increasing and the number of infections is increasing. So, why not you and me? Are you the best? Am I the best of the Ugandans who are still alive? Am I worse? Or are those who died worse than us who are still alive? Is it because you and I are better than those who have died? No, not at all. The only reason I can give is that because the Lord Jesus Christ is with you and is with me. He is with us. Joseph became a man in prison, in slavery. He went as a boy from Canaan, and he became a man in Potiphar's house as a slave. But he even grew older as a man in prison when Potiphar put him in prison. What trying times this young man has gone through. So, someone says, before God can use you mightily, he will hurt you deeply. I think it is Tozer, A.T. Tozer. He says, before God can use you mightily, he will hurt you deeply, deeply. God only uses wounded healers and suffering servants, so that you can connect with their suffering and therefore be able to draw them out of that suffering to look to God. Similarly, Joseph suffered deeply before he could become the prime minister of Egypt and the savior of the entire Middle East, because there was no food. There were 7 years of plenty, and then there were 7 years of drought. But Joseph had already received the signals from God, and he advised Pharaoh, and now he was put in charge of all the food that was needed in the Middle East. So Egypt and all the Arab countries, including Israel, they all came to Egypt in order to get some form of relief from their suffering because of the hunger. I pray that from the ashes of COVID-19 and from the suffering and from all this lockdown activities, that God will do something very special in our lives. That COVID will make our backs strong, it will make our hearts soft, and so that we are able to empathize with everybody that is in this land. And particularly for Africa, I pray that COVID will not crush us, but it will make us strong and will make us to reach out to all the others so that God's name will be glorified even in this pandemic. So with Paul, we can rejoice in our suffering, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not disappoint. Hallelujah. Amen. Hope does not disappoint. Romans chapter 5, verse 3 to 5a. Hope does not disappoint. Tough times call for tough people. Let these tough times put a tough fiber in our systems so that we can even rejoice in these tough times. We can give thanks. We can praise God. We can lift God's name higher in these tough times. Tough times don't last, but tough people do. They last. I pray these tough times will give us special abilities in order to reach out to one another, to reach out to people who are in deeper trouble with us, and also even more than us. He is the wounded healer. He is the one who protects those whom Satan wants to pound and discourage in this walk of faith. Satan put so many arrows on the back of Jesus, but he still is able to shelter us in his arms and protect us even in these tough times. These are difficult times, but there are times when the glory of God can be seen clearly through the faithful people of God. And so with these words, I pray that Uganda Christian University will stand up and be counted among the universities, even if we are suffering like any other university. People will see the difference. And may God bless you. May God honor all your contributions and standing for the Lord so that we can praise God and praise him now and forevermore. Amen. Thank you, and God bless you. Amen.
Amen. Thank you very, very much, Bishop, for allowing God to use you. And I hope that each one of us has been encouraged by that message. Indeed, we are in tough times, but above all, we must be reminded that the presence of God, which sustains us, is with us, and that is the cause for our survival in times like this. We will continue with a brief time of intercession led by our chaplain, the Reverend Engineer Paul Waswa.
Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds my future, and life is worth a living just because he lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow.
how fair is God, because I know He holds my future and life is worth a living just because He lives. Our blessed Heavenly Father, we come to you in the name of the risen Lord Jesus Christ, with that assurance that because He lives, we can face tomorrow. More than that, because He lives, He has opened for us a door through which we can come to you, our Heavenly Father, and bring our concerns to you. Concerns of our individual lives, concerns of our families, concerns of the institutions in which we serve, concerns of the world. Because He lives, we are assured that as we approach your throne of grace, we can approach it with confidence. Blessed be your holy name. Thank you, Lord, for your word to us this morning. Thank you for the example of Joseph and what you did through Joseph, what you did in Joseph and through Joseph. Thank you for that reminder that even when we go through tough times, they can never stop us from our destiny. We will be all that you intended for us to be. And so, Lord, riding on the truth we have shared from the sermon, we pray for everyone at the verge of giving up. The Lord, you will strengthen them. The Lord, you will steady their arms. You will steady their resolve to continue at the post where you have posted them to do what you have called them to do. We'll bring to you homes in a special way this morning, aware of dynamics in the home which are difficult. Sometimes there is bickering, there is hatred, there is backbiting, there is pulling people down. Lord, we bring the messes in the families before you. We bring polygamous families to you. We bring monogamous families to you. Lord, we pray that where there is hatred, there will be love and reconciliation. Where there is evil, that the goodness of the Lord will triumph over evil. Where there is darkness and witchcraft, that the light of the gospel will shine in those homes. Where there is self-centeredness, that a heart and spirit of servanthood will arise. Minister to those homes, Lord. In a special way, we pray for troubled individuals in homes. We especially remember people who are depressed. We remember people who have mental illnesses. Lord, we ask that you will reach out to those homes by your Spirit and minister to those individuals. Us as human beings, we are limited in ways of accessing the feelings of depressed people, the feelings of mentally ill people. But Lord, you are not limited. Come, Holy Spirit, visit those homes, Lord. Visit those homes, Lord. We pray an end to this cycle of suicidal death in families. Lord, may you bring peace in troubled hearts. And for those families who have lost loved ones to suicide, we pray for comfort. We pray for hope. Lord, we repent on behalf of culture which has judged the dead people, not understanding how they died and why they died. Please have mercy upon us. We repent on behalf of the church which many times has judged those people and not provided ministry. Lord, help us as agents of peace, agents of love, to know what to do in such circumstances. And so, Lord, may trouble cease in our homes. For this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Blessed Lord, we continue to thank you for the gift of a new Vice Chancellor. We continue to commit to you, Professor Aaron Mushenjezi, and Patience, the wife and the children. We commit to you the management of UCU with new team members. The Lord, you will bond that team into an effective team. We commit to you the staff of UCU as we serve under new leadership. The Lord, indeed, like we have heard in the sermon, we will stand with the VC, we will die with the VC in aspects of our calling, in aspects of our mission. We commit to you the student community, which is scattered across this country and across this continent, even in America. Lord, we pray that we will rally behind our new team leader and together we'll take this university to higher heights. And so we pray that our gifts will come together, our experiences will come together, our knowledge will be brought together, all for your glory as this institution grows from strength to strength. We commit to you the cabinet of UCU. We pray for your wisdom, even as they navigate the rough waters of seeking to sustain this university. All this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Lord, we bring before you the government of the Republic of Uganda. We'll bring to you our president, His Excellency, Yoweri Kaguta Museveni. We pray for cabinet ministers who have been meeting in this season, seeking wisdom on how to cope with the COVID pandemic. What does it mean for increasing cases? What does it mean for public transport? What does it mean for education systems? What does it mean for the opening of churches? Lord, we pray that the cabinet will tap into your wisdom, that they will hear you speak to them concerning the next steps. We pray against intellectual pride. We pray against selfish interests. We pray for the will of God to prevail in this season. We also call upon you in matters of governance, Lord. We have heard about the proposal for people to pay for testing kits to the tune of 240,000. Lord, you know, you are aware that many of our people cannot afford. And so we pray for a workable solution. All these matters and concerns we commit to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Blessed Heavenly Father, now we bring to you our individual needs. We bring to you our personal needs. The needs of every person you have created. Singles and married people, parents and children, we bring them before you. We especially pray into material needs in this rough economic season. Lord, we are aware that there are many people who are stuck with no money for rent, with no money for food, with no money for medication, with no money for travel, with no money for all forms of upkeep. Lord, we come to you in this service, calling on you, the God of miracles. Our confidence is because Jesus rose from the dead, you will help us face tomorrow. We invoke your promise in 2 Kings chapter 3 and verse 17. Your word says, thus says the Lord, you shall not see wind or rain, but the stream bed shall be filled with water, so that you shall drink you and your livestock and your animals. This is a light thing in the sight of the Lord. What we see as a mountain in our homes, what we see as a mountain in our personal lives, is a light thing before you. So Lord, I pray, Jehovah Jireh, that you provide. Make a way where there seems to be no way. Provide food, O God. Provide medical care, O God. Provide funding for rent and accommodation, O God. Sustain your people. I commit them to you with confidence. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We'll now join in the words of the grace. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forever.
Amen. 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 Thank you very much, Chaplain, for leading us in that time of prayer. And I want to thank each one of you for tuning in, just connecting with us. And I believe that you are blessed. And I want to encourage and make this appeal to you that as much as you can, do share this link with somebody so that they too will be blessed. We will still be airing every Wednesday at 8:30 a.m. and every Sunday at 8:30 a.m. So we pray that you always tune in, and that is the new way of doing things, and we pray for God to bless you. As we come to a close, we will rise and conclude with a hymn. We'll just pray, then I'll ask Bishop to bless us, and then we'll sing the recessional hymn. Make me a channel of your peace. Let us pray. God, we thank you for your word that has come to us, and we just continue to commit everything into your hands, and we pray that as we go through this week, this month that we have just begun, it will be you, O God, who will walk with us every step of the way. May we experience your goodness, and that, Lord, you only will wave away the pandemic COVID-19. And that, Lord God, you keep us in good and perfect health. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name I believe and prayed. Amen.
And now, let's receive the blessing. Now, to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time, and now and forevermore. And the blessings of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you now and always.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. We shall continue with that hymn, Make Me a Channel of Your Peace.
Where there is need. Only light.